Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, DwyerSportsBetting.com, on Roku, in the sports section, Dwyer Boxing and Sports News. On iTunes, one word, Dwyer Boxing News. Remember, the opinion you should follow should be your own. Just consider this video to be a second opinion from a complete stranger online. Just a few quick thoughts. On week 5 of the National Football League, this is a post-mortem before tonight's Monday Night Football game. First, let's talk about the New England Patriots. Now, as I said in the video done before the games took place, reports of the Patriot death were greatly exaggerated. Folks, this team still has the inside track to not only win the division, but to make a nice run in the playoffs. I believe they proved that against Cincinnati. Keep in mind, they held Cincinnati to less than 100 rushing yards. That's combined with holding them to less than 250 passing yards. Right? Basically, Cincinnati, coming off of a bye week, was shut down. Well, let's look a little bit deeper. Right? Let's look at the Patriots' schedule. Keep in mind, the Patriots are 3-2. Keep in mind, the New York Jets have self-immolated. They're pretty much out of the picture in the AFC East. Keep in mind, their main rival, the Buffalo Bills, just changed their quarterback. Right? They're going with Kyle Orton. Next week will be Orton's second game as a starter. The Patriots will be traveling to Buffalo to play Buffalo in a game that has big-time implications. But just understand, they're catching Buffalo at a time where Buffalo's coming off of a game with Kyle Orton. They won it, but they didn't score 20 points. Right? There's still uncertainty with the Bill offense. I would argue, without getting into premium picks, which I post at DwyerSportsBetting.com, I would argue that the Patriots are catching the Bills at the right time. Now, after they play the Bills in Buffalo, they come back home and they play the New York Jets. I would argue that the Jets right now are close to resembling the Michigan Wolverines in football. Right? I believe Rex Ryan is probably on his way out. Right? The Jets players have to realize that this is not their year. One definition of futility would be the stat line Michael Vick threw down yesterday as a backup to Geno Smith. Right? Understand, Geno's having problems. Michael Vick, the backup, might be having bigger problems. Let's say, for argument's sake, that the Patriots win both of those games. The complexion of the season changes. They went into yesterday's game with people wondering if Tom Brady would ever be Tom Brady again. Think about that. By the way, they put up more than 500 yards of total offense against the Cincinnati Bengals yesterday. Right? Well, understand, now they're 3-2. They beat Buffalo, they're 4-2. They beat the Jets, they're 5-2. Then they're still at home. They play the Bears. I think we know from the egg the Bears laid yesterday that the Bears are vulnerable in some games. They have a lot of talent, but sometimes it doesn't show on the scoreboard. I believe that's a winnable game. Then they play the Denver Broncos, but here again, I believe they're catching the Broncos at the right time, because it would be New England's third consecutive home game. Right? If you're going to play Denver, at least you want to be in an environment that's friendly and you want to have been there for some time. Right? Then they get a bye. Coming out of the bye, the Patriots would actually play Indy in Indy. But keep in mind, they would have a prolonged period of time to prepare for Andrew Luck. If you give Bill Belichick and his crew a prolonged period of time to prepare for any opponent, that opponent's going to have their hands full. By the way, after that Colt game, the Patriots come back to Foxborough to play the Detroit Lions, a team that, quite frankly, is hit or miss on the road. So I believe the Patriots already at 3-2 are above 500 after five games, and now they're embarking on a portion of their schedule that actually is manageable. Most of the games are at home, right? One of the tough games is after a bye week. Don't follow the crowd in claiming that the Patriots don't have enough offense and that they're too old and that they lack talent, right? While you're following the crowd, the Patriots will be winning games. Let's talk about another team. My Moneyline Play of the Week delivered. The Steelers also are a team that's unfashionable, right? They weren't even favored by a touchdown over Jacksonville, as if Jacksonville did anything before this game to lead us to believe that they were a serious threat to the Steelers. Well, even given all of that, the Steelers barely covered the line. Now, I wasn't advocating them on a point spread, but the point spread delivered. I was just advocating them on a money line play. But understand, the Steelers are better than advertised. People are gunning the Steelers. I understand the Steelers have gone out there and have looked uninspired, particularly at the end of the Tampa Bay game the week before this one. But understand, the Steelers still have one of the league's best quarterbacks, multiple Super Bowl winner Ben Roethlisberger. Let's remember, too, Ben got to a third Super Bowl. That was the Super Bowl in which he lost to Aaron Rodgers. Right? So you're talking about one of the league's most tested, most proven, most successful quarterbacks. And just look at the yards per carry of people like Le'Veon Bell. The Steelers have a rushing attack. Yesterday, Dick LeBeau was able to hold Jacksonville to under 10 points. Right, the defense has their moments. Now let's talk about what surprised me. First, the New Orleans Saints defense. The Saints won. Hey, I'm a happy camper. As I said in the pre-game video, I wasn't advocating the Saints to cover a double-digit spread. Right? But I did think the Saints would win the game. I did not expect that game to go into overtime. I didn't expect the Saints to have to come from behind just to tie the game in a game they were playing at home. I didn't expect their defense to look as bad as it did and to give up over 30 points. Right? One coach who should be on the hot seat should be Saint defensive coordinator Rob Ryan. Let's just say it hasn't been a good year coaching for the Ryan family. Right, I was much more bullish on the Saints at the start of the year than I am now. Their defense doesn't look playoff worthy. They're going to have to right that ship. They can't expect to score 37 points every week. Right? Let me also talk about another thing that surprised me. Peyton Manning at home. Arizona, quite frankly, remains one of the league's elite defenses. I still believe that. But I'll concede Peyton Manning's a juggernaut. Right? He put on a show. The game was close. Peyton Manning broke it open. They blew away the under, which I had advocated before the game. Let's just say Peyton Manning is always an MVP candidate anytime he's healthy and on the field. I thought yesterday was really interesting, too, because, you know, to me, Manning looks unstoppable against even elite defenses at home. I thought it was an absolutely dominant performance. Let me point out, too, that it just so happens that while the New York Jets are reeling, right? I mean, Geno Smith's numbers were terrible. Michael Vick's numbers were worse. You know, the Jets became the first team this season to be shut out last year. This week, right? First team this year to be shut out. And now, of course, they have to travel back home, right? The Jets have to travel through several time zones to face the Denver Broncos in New Jersey. Good luck with that. I think that's a win for the Broncos. Let's go further. The game after that. The Broncos get to play a team that I've been saying here in practically every video is vastly overrated. This team, again, did not cover yesterday, right? In a home game, they failed to cover. In fact, they failed to get to 25 points. And that's the San Francisco 49ers. I consider that to be a winnable game, right? San Francisco traveling to Denver to play Denver in Denver. If Peyton Manning is healthy, I think Peyton Manning wins that game rather handily. Let's talk about the 49ers for a moment, right? I got a call from a good friend. He said, "Huh, look, the 49ers won." Sounds good to me. I won, too, because the 49ers didn't cover 6.5 points. Right? Let me just say, look at Colin Kaepernick's numbers for yesterday. Look at his numbers for the week before yesterday. Look at his numbers from 2 weeks ago. Are you sure that this guy deserves a top dollar salary at the quarterback position? Are you even sure this guy's an elite quarterback? If you were filling out a Pro Bowl ballot today, would Colin Kaepernick be on that Pro Bowl ballot? I'll tell you, I saw the game in a 49er bar. Right? Let's just say Brandon Lloyd in particular made an acrobatic catch on a ball that was just a jump ball. As you look at the Niner passing attack, you're not looking at precision. Let me also point out, too, that Kaepernick doesn't hit guys in crowds. When you see Aaron Rodgers, you'll frequently notice that his receivers are covered, right? Jordy Nelson will have a guy right on his shoulder. Then Nelson will cut. The ball will be there. Green Bay wide receivers don't have to be open. Their offense is so finely tuned that Aaron Rodgers is working off movement, right? Aaron Rodgers is working off the back shoulder. He's throwing it into coverage, knowing that his receiver will make a break and will be the only person with a chance to catch the football. That's not what I'm seeing in San Francisco. I'm seeing Kaepernick either hitting guys wide open or throwing plays where wide receivers have to make acrobatic catches. And even with the acrobatic catches, Kaepernick can't get to 300 passing yards. Right? By the way, that's in a home game. Right? So, you look at that game yesterday. I'm telling you, if the 49ers don't have a fake punt attempt, if Jim Harbaugh doesn't out-coach Andy Reid down the stretch, the Niners could well have lost that game. As it was, they didn't cover. Now, next week, they play the worst team in their division, the Rams. Right? I believe the line's 3.5. If you go back to last year, you're going to see that the Niners beat the Rams both times they played last year and would have covered 3.5-point lines. I'm not here to express an opinion on next week's game. But the week after that, assuming there aren't big injuries, assuming Peyton Manning doesn't re-aggravate an old injury, if everyone's healthy, I don't see how the 49ers beat the Denver Broncos in Denver. Right? So let's just say, take a look at that AFC West. San Diego is a juggernaut. So too are the Denver Broncos. Obviously, KC is the kind of team that can also rise up and beat a very good Patriot team. Right? Let me point out too, this is the meat part of the Broncos schedule because the week after they play the 49ers, they play the San Diego Chargers. Then the week after that is when they travel to play the New England Patriots. Let me make an obvious point. Right? You can imagine that the Broncos view the team they played in the playoffs last year from their division, the Chargers, as their primary competition. Right? Let's just think it through. You have a game against the physical 49ers. You then have a game against your division nemesis, the San Diego Chargers. Doesn't that open the door for the Broncos to be flat when they travel to the Patriots to play them the week after playing the San Diego Chargers? Right? I would argue that the Patriots will be more prepared for that game than the Denver Broncos. Right? So, just to sum up, you need to look at the Patriots, you need to look at their division, you need to realize that the division is manageable, the team isn't as bad as advertised, in fact, the team right now is over 500, right? They have a quarterback who has won 3 Super Bowls, but has actually been in 5 Super Bowls. 5. You have an offense that was maligned that just put up more than 500 yards of total offense, right? If you don't think the Patriots are a play, then you haven't looked at their schedule. Folks, they play the Jets in 2 weeks. Okay, so just keep an eye on the Patriots. Also keep an eye on the Niners. Let me say this for different reasons. Right, there are a new batch of stories. I've posted one of them on gamblersadvisory.com about how Jim Harbaugh, according to insiders like Jay Glazer, is not going to be back next year. Right? Understand. Let's talk about the Michigan job. Harbaugh doesn't even have to take the Michigan job to benefit from the opening that's going to be at Michigan. Because everyone knows Jim Harbaugh is a Michigan man. Everyone knows he was a very successful college coach. He's the reason why the Stanford Cardinal is back in BCS Bowls. Right? Is on the world stage. And so, the point is this. If Harbaugh's in demand at Michigan, if he's just one of the finalists or one of the main people being considered at Michigan, that's going to increase his popularity in general among teams looking for buzz, right? Teams looking for a new coach who's going to conjure up excitement among their fan base, right? And keep in mind, too, you have some coaches in some key places. Rex Ryan, for example, New York City, that right now are on the hot seat. Big city, bright lights, who knows, right? Anyway, let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. And of course, I will be posting premium picks up at thewiresportsbetting.com later this week. Thanks for stopping by.